Good. How we can hear? I think we're more or less there. Okay, thanks, Kunti. Appreciate it. Okay. Good, you can go. You're just fine. Thanks very much indeed. We'll finish at 2 o'clock. I'm sorry to have finished a bit late yesterday. But before we finish today, I'll of course be... yesterday we announced the Oscar for the greatest actor and TV and media personality of all times. And today we'll be announcing the award which I've made to the greatest South African of all times. The greatest South African, bar none. The South African who saved this country. Spoiler alert, it's not Nelson Mandela. But I will be announcing before the end of today who the greatest of all South African is. While yesterday was about how the media, haven't started yet, this is just introductory, Claire. The media, yesterday I was focusing on the media and the world, how events are represented, what is true, what isn't true. Today is, yesterday was titled from President Kennedy to President Underwood. Today is South Africa, black and white of full color, and deals with race in South Africa as represented through the media. And of course, don't forget, before the end of the day, I will be announcing who is the greatest South African of all times, really of all times, and the guarantor of our democracy. And I, in fact, will go down on my knees to her or to him to really express my feelings. But media in South Africa started off quite late. There wasn't much in the way of television. I mentioned that yesterday, but I think we should start off with this particular one, given
that sudden constitutional upheavals which created dictatorships in certain parts of Africa.
So you don't have to hear what he's saying. That is Dr. Verwoerd. He was the Prime Minister of South Africa. And he's speaking in 1961, very pleasantly for World Media for PATH, P-A-T-H-E, which is also an interesting name in the history of film. And he's explaining South Africa's policy regarding black people. And he said that Dr. Verwoerd himself thought the TV, the medium which we're all familiar with, was very bad. He said he compared it to atomic bombs and poison gas. I'd like to be serious for a second and say he really did say an introduction of TV in South Africa would be equivalent to that. Albert Herzog, who was the Minister of Posts and Telegraphs, who was in touch with us, said specifically that the reason for not introducing TV in South Africa was to keep blacks and whites from mixing. And he said that if TV was allowed in South Africa, black South Africans would see films from overseas where they would see blacks and whites mixing and they would be dissatisfied with their lives. The TV would increase dissatisfaction because the South African policy was one of gradual evolution of each of the groups. And Verwoerd, in this speech, which the sound isn't great, speaks about the idea of South Africa consisting of different groups. The point I want to make to you, I'm not giving a history of apartheid, I want to say that the media was used, and the message from the media was that there are many different groups in South Africa. It's not whites and blacks, but that black South Africans are in many groups. Whites were united, but blacks were of all different groups. There were different racial groups. And part of the Verwoerd idea was that each of the groups of black South Africans should have representation in their own way, in a meaningful way. So this is the next clip.
Chief Matanzima, I presume that you can tell us quite a lot about the possibilities of the Transkei. Say, for instance, in the event of total independence, would you say that the Transkei has the manpower and the talent to run its own affairs?
The Bantu people of the Republic of South Africa are the most developed of all the Bantu states in the continent of Africa. And there is no doubt that there is plenty of manpower for self-determination in the Transkei.
Could you tell us what the future possibilities of the Transkei are?
The Transkei is a country with wonderful resources for its future.
So Matanzima was a hand-chosen black so-called leader. He was important at his time. In fact, he was at Nelson Mandela's wedding. I think he might have even been his best man. He was the chosen country. I think, is it too loud or is it okay? Okay, he was chosen by the apartheid government to represent the Transkei, to be the leader of the independent Transkei, the president over there. And this idea was promoted in the media in South Africa. And the representation of an educated, well-dressed black person was very important to South Africa. And this idea that black people would see their country being the Transkei and the other self-governing bodies was excellently delivered by media in South Africa. Media in South Africa was focused very much on the idea of apartheid. When television was introduced in South Africa in 1975, I think, a bit earlier, about 1972, the original plan was to have TV in South Africa for whites and TV in South Africa for blacks. But by the time the TV was introduced, they dropped that idea, and they had TV in English and in Afrikaans. The idea of allowing black people TV, or seeing TV and seeing images which they would make them dissatisfied, was a very big theme in South Africa at that time. So the apartheid government was very aware of the fact that media was critical to its presentation of the South Africa that it wanted to see. What happened to Matanzima in the end? Well, he survived reasonably well. He survived through to the 21st century. He broke with Mandela. Mandela didn't like him to be represented at any event. He was didn't even go to his funeral because he thought that would be in some way, Mandela thought going to Matanzima's funeral would in some way acknowledge that this idea that is put out into there that there could be independent Bantustans was wrong. And this is the person who was the archetypal black for hire of the South African government. He didn't do well in his political career. He was enormously corrupt. Other members of his entourage were enormously corrupt and was a failed experiment. But the media in South Africa was used phenomenally by the white government, who controlled all the media, to present this particular image of how black people should be. I played early on some songs from Hospital Tate. Any of you remember? An Hospital Tate on home. Many of you will be familiar with it. What I want to say is that the ubiquity of media for white people was clear. There was only one source of media in South Africa, and that was the SABC. That was the official media. And it can be difficult for us today to understand what that means, because we have media in our pockets. We can log on to The Guardian, we can log on to the Cape Times while it's still around before they close it down and get that whatever. But at that time, there was only one source. You're looking at a time where there was no internet. There were only the official news avenues. And even the white liberal press wasn't that liberal. So South Africans didn't really know what was happening. In talking about South Africa and race and color in media, I wanted to play you a few clips from this unbelievable film, which you might recognize, and came out in South Africa in the mid-70s. It was a sensation. Cry Freedom. And this is the protagonist.
Change the way people think and things will never be the same. What's the government's reaction?
Tense. Troops have been sent in to restore order.
I'm sorry that the sound isn't more. Kanti, can we do anything about the sound, Kanti? Okay. Well, we'll have to try and manage. This is the two protagonists in the film Cry Freedom. Any of you seen, by a show of hands, the film Cry Freedom? Okay, the film came out in the mid-70s. It is a film which was filmed in Zimbabwe. It couldn't possibly be filmed in South Africa. If you make it any louder, be careful. It was filmed in Zimbabwe. The two main actors were? Denzel Washington and? So the two main actors were Kevin Kline and Denzel Washington. Quite amazingly, in this incredible film, Kevin Kline has the first billing. It's really a story about Kevin Kline and about Kevin Kline was representing an editor. What is his name? Donald Woods. So the fascinating thing about this iconic film, I'm going to show you some scenes which you don't need the sound to really hear. The incredible thing about the film is that the focus was on the white person. More about this later. So even in an iconic film like this, the white person was the story of Donald Woods was the more saleable story. And the young black actor took the role of Biko, which was Denzel Washington, was almost the add-on person. Okay, so I'm gonna play a bit of this thing. We hope we get some sound over here. Filmed in Harare in Zimbabwe, This is showing the scenes, as it were, of the Soweto uprising. So here are black school children, we'll come to another black so-called school child a little bit later, representing people who are oppressed by a language policy, fighting for freedom. Look at the caricatures of the black school children and of the white policemen. Listen to the accents.
Stop right there. This is an illegal gathering. I'm giving you 3 minutes to disperse. Go home. I'm warning you. Representation of white soldiers representing a regime, black students representing a desire for their freedom. This great film, I love the film, but there's been a great deal of criticism of it subsequently. One of the images for me is of the poor black students, they're school children, they're being shot. So I'm not wanting to detract in any way from the terrible experience. But a point is reached in South Africa a few years ago when many black people, including many black students at UCT, decided that they were sick and tired of seeing blacks always being represented in media as being victims. They didn't deny that these were victims. They didn't deny that this was a cruel process. But they said, it can't be that the only representation that people see of black South Africans is of people who are victims of police shooting. There must be another representation. And there was a fight at UCT over the paintings at UCT, the pictures, the photographs at UCT, some of you might remember, 3 or 4 years ago. And the Vice Chancellor at the time, Max Price, was instrumental in taking down many pictures at UCT, which were classic pictures taken by great photographers, some of whom were incensed by that decision, because they represented black suffering. They were apartheid-era liberal images which showed black suffering in South Africa. And black students said, SLC at UCT, we are sick and tired of having blacks only represented as victims. We want that stuff taken down. We want heroes in many forms. We want expression. We don't only want political heroes. So part of the issue of the media in South Africa is the representation in a classic way of blacks at that time as black, whites as white, and even in a so-called liberal perspective, not a Dr. Wood perspective, there's something problematic in that presentation. On the same theme, some of you may remember this particular show a while ago in South Africa. Do you know the song? That is in 1974, 1975, it became, any of you ever see Ipitombi? Some of you might know the music. No black people were involved in this at all. This is a representation, one of the most amazing things to be a representation of black South Africans. The woman who made it, her name was Bertha Egnos. Interesting life, interesting career. Her husband is an interesting person. And they made this play generally about pretty happy black people. Media representations at that time about black people were always of black people as being happy, happy, accepting, tribal. It was, at the time, a music which I remember seeing and loving. I remember the song, Mama Tem was getting married tonight. I was a white South African living in South Africa at that time. It seemed to me, well, that's where it is. But the media
creates a representation of what people are like, reality is like, but it reflects that reality, but it also creates the reality. So I'm suggesting to you that Ipi and Tombi at the time was an unbelievable thing. It was a play entirely done by white people, and the people who were watching in the theatres were entirely white people for one obvious reason. No blacks were allowed. So the idea of representing reality through media and how it's used by governments and societies is very part of much what we're talking about today. In the same theme, a beautiful thing which I've always loved, this particular concert, 1987.
I said, take this child from the town.
Who's the woman? Mary McKeever. Who's the man? Where's it filmed? Harare.
Township of Mofolo, give her the wings to fly through harmony. She won't bother you no more. This is the story of how we begin to remember.
I just love this.
This is the power pulsing
around in the rain.
After the dream of falling and calling your name.
It's almost ruined Paul Simon's life.
These are the roots of rhythm, and the roots of rhythm remain.
I think, what can be wrong with this? Well, it really almost ruined Paul Simon's life. I've read the biography, recent biography of Paul Simon. It's a major issue in his life. What Paul Simon did wrong by black South Africans was what? He broke the boycott. So even though he thought he was doing a great thing with Ladysmith and Black Mambazo, your crowd, at the time he was reviled. How dare he make music in South Africa? He came to South Africa. How dare he use South African artists? So we're seeing a shift over here, where once upon a time, the media images were controlled by white people who could put out what they wanted for blacks. And even the so-called liberal whites, who wanted to present an image of black South Africans and Ipi and Tombi, thought that is a nice thing. But then there started to be a consciousness among black people, and the word black consciousness comes from Biko, of course, and others, that no, we do not want to be represented how white people want to represent us. So this fantastic concert, love the music. Can watch the, I got the video once when I bought some music from Paul Simon, and came with us as a free video with it. I love it. But there were deep political undertones about representation, how the South African events are being represented. I'm gonna play a bit more before I get to my most shocking video of the day. So I thought today's lecture is called South African Black and White or Full Colour. This is a great representation of black and white together, but many people didn't see it that way. The next one is very dated, I think, remarkable, and I find this amazing, and you'll of course recognize the Cantonian boy. Who is she? Brenda Fassie. She was from down the road. A most unusual South African indeed. Had a remarkable life, to put it mildly. She's died a while ago, and she was 35 years old at the time of making of this, and you'll recognize some people in this. What's she dressed as? Is this vaguely possible today? Could you get away with this? Could anyone of 35 be dressed in a provocative short dress at the age of 35 as a schoolgirl and look at her actions, and then you'll see some of the people who are applauding her? In the cancel culture of today, those people who are sitting in the audience applauding her would be banned today. Certain UCT wouldn't allow them to come and give a lecture over here. That would be regarded as shocking. Look at this performance. It's highly sexualized. She was a drug addict. She was a phenomenal entertainer. The song is called Wooden Glenna. It's about a wedding. It features in a movie which I made recently. Have a look. Yellow. recognize anyone in the audience yet? I wouldn't want to be seen on video having been in this audience and applauding and enjoying this. In an age of Me Too, a 35-year-old woman dressed up provocatively in a short school skirt with a school lunch bag is appalling. Think how times have changed. This is only 17 years ago. Wait for it. Chancellor of UCT. Chancellor of UCT. And the person who I will not name is the greatest African. So how times change. So the Me Too movement is upon us, and images, what we see, and what we even allow to see and witness, have really changed. So I'm suggesting to you that starting with things like Cry Freedom, a movie which represents Donald Woods as more significant in the titles than the character of Biko. Today that would reverse it, there's no doubt. Today we're in a political age where the black guy who was the dominant figure in the narrative, he was the figure, the guy who was killed, would be put first. But those were different times. In the age of Ipi Tombi, it's changed now. And the idea of the president of South Africa, and Graça Machel, who became the chancellor of UCT, watching this performance by a 35-year-old woman pretending to be a highly sexualized teen, it's just simply not possible. Well, times change, and I want to show you one from previous times. Some of you may remember this.
Good morning. Welcome,
Ellen Erasmus,
to the special TV One newscast. White South Africans are flocking to the polls today in one of the country's most historic referendums, a referendum which will decide the future of South Africa.
This is 1992. Nelson Mandela is out of jail. White South Africans are voting in that referendum whether black people should be allowed to go free or not. Today you think, did that really happen? Did white South Africans, I don't want to say we over here, well, did we go to an election and vote yes and no? What happens if we had voted no? We don't agree with F.W. de Klerk's proposals. Then what would have happened? Would have Nelson Mandela and the ANC said, well, okay, sorry, we can't have our freedom. So look at a bit more about this.
We have reports on the latest developments at some of the polling stations. Voting began briskly in Pretoria this morning. Queues formed at all the polling booths before voting began at 7 o'clock.
It's almost jarring to see only white people. Have a look.
There was a lively atmosphere at a school in Arcadia, where President F.W. de Klerk and his wife Marika brought out their votes. A smiling Mr. de Klerk told the Horde of International Newsmen that he was optimistic about the result.
Regis, ja.
Is he optimistic, Mr. de Klerk?
Ek is optimistisch. Ek dink dit sal goed gaan. Hier is wonderlike enthousiasme. En ons kry terugvoering dat die mense vinnig stem, flink stem en enthousiasties.
That was our lives in this country. Today, I remember the first time I turned on the radio, heard the morning news, and there's a black person, see, I'm going to be well behaved today, I'm not going to imitate what they sound like, reading the news. And I remember saying to somebody who's in the room with you, it was so jarring to my ears. I can't imitate it because they're recording this and I'd be in trouble, but it was a black person saying, good morning, this is the news, this is the SABC. It was jarring to the ear. Today, the media is entirely black. The news presenters, the news readers, and we don't even notice that. It's become so entirely second nature to us. But this was in 1992, not that long ago.
In Nelstrom, where the leader of the Conservative Party, Dr. Andries Treelt, cast his vote, some people even brought their children along to witness the historic referendum. Dr. Treelt said he was confident of winning the ballot.
And he was voting no. He said black South Africans shouldn't be allowed free. Ellen Erasmus, whatever happened to her? Is she still around? I don't know. Anyone know what happened to Ellen Erasmus? She evidently left the country for 2 years, and now she's living, I think, in George on Eisner. She's an educationist. She runs a school over there, and she's had a very interesting and, I think, a successful life. But she was once a newsreader who was well known. And then a news clipping, which you all know, you all will remember this particular one. Iconic. Look for the guy who's helping to push the crowds aside as they come through. I'll move it along a little bit.
There's Mr. Mandela, Mr. Nelson Mandela, a free man
taking his
Who's
first
this guy over here moving the people away, keeping them aside? That young man with the beard.
Mrs. Winnie Mandela next to him, waving to the crowds. Hand in hand, they leave the Victor Verster prison.
There he is, he's like clearing the way for them.
Of the National Reception Committee trying to get the people.
Isn't the videos wonderful? What a happy couple rejoicing. They were the unhappiest couple in history. He couldn't stand her. More is being written constantly on his relationship with her. More to come out next, this coming year, I think, on that particular relationship. But they were not friends at this stage. And this is a representation in the media of her coming out holding his hand. Then they drove along the highways. I'll show you a bit more of this video.
Alongside the car.
Then they drove along the highway. This is very interesting. Very contentious, this drive. Fast crowd. And then came to the parade. I was there that day. It was quite scary to have been a white person there, I remember. Jay Naidu. And that's Sisulu, who introduces Mandela. And Mandela's first words are... Cyril holding the mic. That is the day Nelson Mandela came out of jail. Things aren't in exact subsequential order. This was before the referendum. But he's the iconic media figure of South Africa. He's the first South African to have become truly an international global superstar. He's probably the South African who was amongst the most seen. If I had to do a thing, if I could do a calculation of a South African who has been seen by more people, individual eyeballs looking at them, Nelson Mandela would probably be the number two, the second most recognizable South African in all history, the person who is world icon. More people have seen him on TV than every other South African, except for one we'll get to later. But that's Nelson Mandela, an iconic figure. First president of South Africa, and his image is fantastic. So the media represented Mandela as the most fantastic person. He was the most mediagenic personality. Nobody quite like him. Well, certainly the following person isn't like him at all, and you can hear what he has to say.
You see, when you ask the question, does HIV cause AIDS? The question is, does a virus cause a syndrome? How does a virus cause a syndrome? It can't. It really, truly, it's necessary, I've been saying to the honorable members, to the people in this country, it's necessary for people to study this question. You see, when you ask...
That's Thabo Mbeki, and he's saying there's no link between HIV and AIDS. He was an AIDS denialist. The Harvard study, as I mentioned yesterday, said if 330,000 South Africans died unnecessarily through HIV, who wouldn't have died hadn't been for the policy. Many would have died. But the policy of HIV was one of his strong points. And he appears to the media, and he always wanted to appear that way, and he still does, as an intellectual black person. Comparing very much to a person like Kaiser Matanzima earlier, his brand, Mbeki, was intellectualism. He spoke about HIV AIDS in an intellectual way, with his pipe. He was the image of what he thought would sell well, which was a black intellectual. And he was, I think, a much despised man among certain quarters. He was replaced by the ANC, who got Mr. Clean to replace him, a man who certainly wouldn't have been accused of intellectualism after a certain period of... But then they got Jacob Zuma. Nobody thought he was an intellectual. In fact, Jacob Zuma's appeal was his very earthiness. So he is in contradistinction to Mbeki, who was portrayed by himself and the media as an intellectual, that Zuma, the earthy man, was so popular. And that was his motif as well. So I hope I'm giving you an idea of how the media have represented South Africans at various stages of our engagement.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Can you speak up?
The representation you show here is not a true representation of black South Africa.
I've been showing black leaders. I've been showing Mandela. What are you trying to say?
Well,
I'm sure there are black people. Look, look, who? Look, if you can do better than me, why don't you? They pay me over here. If you can do better than me, why don't you come over here and tell us what you're talking about? So, what do you say her name is? Have you heard of Zozibini Tunzi? What's she in the media for? Okay, can you hear Cindy, or do you want to use my microphone? No, okay, you can use the microphone over there. Just put this over there. I think we're good. You stand up here. So let me find Zozibini Tunzi. Can I do that? Okay, Zozibini Tunzi over here.
Pardon?
Okay,
there we go.
It's been a year of milestones in the world of beauty pageants. For the first time in history, Miss World, Miss America, Miss Universe, Miss USA, and Miss Teen USA are all black women. Joining me now is Miss Universe, Zozibini Tunzi. She said I could call her Zozi for short, so I think I'm going
to
do
it. Do you think it's right to call her Zozi for short?
No, her name is Zozibini.
But it's difficult for us to say, like, you know, give us a break.
It's tough. I can say Khat.
What?
Khat.
Okay. So who is
Am I supposed to call him G for short? I mean.
What's so important about it?
Zozibini is the current reigning Miss USA. She was first Miss Universe. I beg your pardon, Miss Universe. And she's iconic because look at her hair. She's wearing an amazing crown on your typical black nappy hair.
Hold on.
Zozi, thank you so much. Congratulations on your win.
Thank you so much for having me. Excited to be here.
So before we talk about your victory, I want to ask about something that you said in your closing address on Sunday when you were on stage. You said, quote, "I grew up in a world where a woman who looks like me with my kind of skin and my kind of hair was never considered beautiful. I think it is time that stops today." Growing up in South...
I'm just going to put that on the screen a moment in the back. I grew up in a world where a woman who looked like me, with my kind of skin and my kind of hair, is never considered beautiful. I want children to look at me and see my face. So she has no false fake hair on.
No.
What does it mean to you?
It means everything to me. She's revolutionized what the idea of beauty is. And that is the black representation that should be in the media. It is in the media, but we just don't see it. Well, certainly, I don't think... Yes, me and my kids see it. Yep. Now, when I tell my kid, "You're so beautiful, you look like Miss Universe," she knows exactly what I'm talking about.
Okay. Let's try another one over here. Let's get this over here.
Monang Matheba. Do you know who Monang Matheba is?
Wait,
do you know who Monang Matheba is? Is she well known?
She's very much well known.
So, I am usually just a very cordial person. I get at that piece. Like, we had a shoot, I think it was for Tropica in Cape Town, and he was there, myself and him, and a couple of other celebrities, and we're all in one room. And now we're like,
why is she, who is she?
She is a very big media personality. She's a presenter on TV. She's got her own show. She's got her own wine. She's essentially what every black woman wants to be. She is the epitome of success as a black woman.
And her name is?
Monang Matheba.
What's her personal life like? Do we know anything about
her? We know a lot about her personal life. She dated AKA, who is a rapper, who she stole apparently from.
Who she stole AKA from?
She stole her from a DJ called DJ Zinke.
What's AKA's real name? Eden Forbes. That's correct.
There you go.
You know, I didn't even prepare you for this. That's very good. Eden Forbes. So she's got AKA, spelled AKA, is a significant personality. And the loves and lives of these people are day by day fair for black Twitter. It's endless.
Endless.
Do you like her?
She's aight.
What's your
I'm a little bit jealous of her, I will admit, but no, she's very inspirational.
I'd like to go to a bit of Ned Beck now if we can. Who is that person?
Somizi Mhlongo.
Somizi
Mhlongo. Mhlongo, yes.
Okay.
Okay. Hit me. Go for it. So Mr. Mhlongo is the ultimate gay personality in South Africa. He recently, yes, he makes... No, that was during your time. Our time, being gay is perfectly fine. Being black and gay is even better.
How are you?
I'm fine, how are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Please come in and have a seat. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you. Can I be comfortable?
Of course. What has been your journey and how has this industry influenced that line about your relationship with money?
My granny was a domestic worker who worked part-time jobs. And she was the breadwinner, sole breadwinner. My mother and my father, they've always been in entertainment.
Yes.
So money would come in and out. Today we have lots of money. Next week could be broke as if we've never had a cent. Mm. So I grew up not kind of respecting money.
So here is a media icon in South Africa. His following is beyond all imagination, and Nedbank is using him to make money because they want to appeal to black clients. The next one is far more controversial, and we're going to get on to one of the most controversial people in the country.
In this up and down, intangible, suffocating, invisible cloud that's tailor-made to make me less. Undi tatara nini, undi jongela pansibo, utingu bandubani na, utingu bandubani na.
What's her name?
Kelly Khumalo. She is a singer. She's a great entertainer.
What do you think of her?
I think she's a great singer.
Any of you know who she's married to? Senta. 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 One person knows that you've met. Who else? Who is Senta? Socrates. He was the captain of the South African soccer team. What happened to him? He was murdered. Where? In her house in front of her. Who did the murdering? Nobody knows. So this is a portal into a whole world which is very black, very non-white. It's not white people not really into this. Many white people can't recognize fabulous stories. But there's no black South African who's not captivated by stories regarding Senzo, her, the suspicions on her and her family. Tell me what you think of all that whole business.
I don't know. She has a reputation for, well, her partners never really live very long, so. That is true. On Twitter right now, they're kind of hoping that Cyril would date her. So.
Do we know anything about Cyril? Don't say. Do you know anything about Cyril? Who he dates? His loves and life? Don't say.
Okay.
Plenty around about that. Now I apologize. We had to do it. This is probably the most significant media-hungry celebrity. Who's that man?
That is Mumpy Ja.
We'll speak about him later.
It's okay. It's okay. Wash.
Would you let your kids watch this?
No. You'd not want to dance when you listen to that.
What sort of music is this? What is gom?
Gom is that type of music. Gom. So it's what you're saying, but give it more oomph.
What do you think of her?
She's a great performer, great entertainer. Not much to say about her personal life.
So amazed. Watch this. Zodwa.
Who's Zodwa?
Zodwa Bantu. She is, I don't know how to describe Zodwa. She is an anomaly of sorts.
Yo, Lomfazi.
I'm
nithi abantu bangithanda.
That is actually, this picture is actually one of the very rare pictures or rare sightings of Zodwa Abantu fully dressed.
She's known for never wearing
anything.
One particular garment she never wears.
Can I say that? Oh, okay. Fancies. Yes. Yes, so that is how she became famous.
She's got a great figure and everything.
She does have, she has a great butt, I think.
Not too much.
No, that's an African bum right there.
Are you allowed to say things like
I can, I said bum.
His toilet.
Yes.
Now I'm blue toilet.
Yep.
How are you doing, bro?
Good to see you, bro.
Good to see you too, man.
Who's the guy with the hat?
That is Maps Maponyane, who aka Mr. Buns himself. No, that's only because he owns a burger joint.
Who was Maps?
Maps Maponyane's dad is Mark Maponyane, who was a soccer star from your time. Yep. Yeah, that's Mark.
So what we see Eve was over here, just watch a little bit more of the step and we'll
You know
Fez, right?
What's going on?
It's okay. Come here.
No, we're all
just embrace it. What's embrace it? Yes. So good.
Are you a little bit touched? What's going on?
What's happening here, guys?
So you and Jonathan have your bromance or whatever. So Harmony and I go way back.
Dude.
And he comes over now and again. We chill, we watch a movie. Actually, just in time, I was about to show him the party trick.
How you doing, bro?
So these are iconic black figures in South Africa. They're extremely well known to black South Africans. They're not that well known to many white South Africans. The fact that somebody over here knew something about the South African soccer captain, so on, but these are figures who are well known to black South Africans today. And the media image of who black South Africans are has changed dramatically since the early times over here. So there's a juxtaposition. These are contemporary figures. They have enormous followings. They are influencers. And they're able to sell lots of stuff. They're very rich. Their sex lives are public, their public lives are public, their private lives are public, and they are very in demand in South Africa. But I want to go back to an earlier time now, and on the theme of the snake, I thought that it might be worth keeping the theme of the snake and ask if you remember this person.
Come on, sleepy. You're stolen property, but now you're mine.
Those of you who don't want to see any nudity can look down. That is Glenda Kemp and the snake. I think she's an interesting figure. We had a snake with Zodwa, and now we have a snake with Glenda Kemp. At the time, I think that she was an important figure in South Africa. There was no real opposition in South Africa. There was no real alternate media. But she represented something which was very alternate. Some of you may remember, Glenda Kemp. What is the snake's name? A snake was called Opa, that's correct. And she was frequently arrested. Her husband, ex-husband, by the way, was killed this year. I wonder what happened to her. She was the type of person who, if there was any alternate view in South Africa, besides the government view, she presented that alternate view. But she was a great artist. And her alternate was not bringing blacks into the picture. It was more about snakes and about some sort of Afrikaans sexuality, which was very desirable at the time. But she was the counterculture figure. At the time, there was no real black counterculture in South Africa. What happened to her? Anyone know? Is she still around, alive? She wasn't killed by a snake, no. She has a remarkable movie you can get on YouTube with full nudity, but she was in her day somebody quite interesting, and she's still around today. She's a very serious, completely and utterly committed Christian. Well, if any of you recognize this and are not embarrassed to say that you recognize it, it'll be interesting. Let's have a look what life goes on in South Africa.
So.
What is it?
The villagers. Ronald's going to be best man.
What's my brother got that I haven't?
Oh, they wouldn't let you in on the act. It's a wedding, not a blinking circus.
Strike a blow for equality. Have two best men.
Best men, man? Can't you speak English?
Look, why not have Ronnie and me? Why discriminate?
You mean you haven't heard?
Heard what?
We've got a job for you.
I can guess. Chauffeur.
Page boy. You should see your outfit.
Frilly shirt, velvet knickerbockers. I've always wanted to be one of those.
One of those. He makes a reference to somebody who's gay. One of those. Think how times have changed. Couldn't be done anymore. This is a white series, one of the earliest series of The Villagers. It represented many things about South Africa and created a great reality. It wasn't only an adult soapy, it had some significant things, and there were some black people in bed. There were the black people. They were minors. So the blacks weren't principals in this movie. There were black people, but they were always workers. So in a media representation of what South Africa was, blacks were generally menial workers in that situation, but the films reflected that, and the reflection also created some of the reality. So you'll see a scene over here. First you see the black workers, and then you see the people who really made the decisions. A very tame love scene in The Villagers. It never got more hot than this. No breaths. Sadly. Suddenly they interrupted. So you recognize some of the people. That is Life Gang in South Africa. That is from The Villagers. I imagine one of you, you may remember in some way.
Stransky back in the pocket. Has the chance to drop the
goal. What's about to happen? Do you want to see it?
Back it comes to...
You all know what happens. What happens? The year is 1995. Joel Stransky kicks the kick, and they kneel on afterwards, the final whistle goes, and they kneel on the field afterwards, and what do they do? He calls them Franco Puna, and he calls them, and they pray on the field. Things have really changed. That was the World Cup. Well, that is World Cup in 1995. That's after the changeover taking place. How many players of color were in the team? One, and his name was? Chester, where is he today? Sadly. He wrote a book about his life and so on. He wrote about James Small and the racist comments he had to endure. Where's James Small today? We're still alive. It was a South African team at an entirely different time. A South African team, which is a white team with one colored man, playing in 1995. And it was a great iconic moment for many South Africans. Well, I suppose there were many South Africans who it wasn't such an iconic moment for. Let's have a look at a more modern scene about somebody taking a walk. I've got the walk over here, B14. I don't have the walk. Sorry. Life, no. I'm going to take this particular scene over here, and I'm going to first of all say something about. I was going to show you a picture of. I was going to show you a video of Cyril Ramaphosa taking a morning walk. Any of you ever seen him taking a walk? Any of you seen him in person taking a walk? He's a very interesting figure. He's quiet, he's very slow, he's very deliberate. A lot of people I hear, especially my family, tell me he's not doing enough, he should be doing more. That's not his style at all. That's not Cyril's particular style. He is contradistinctive to the person who came before him. His media image is very different indeed. His media image is being deliberate, thoughtful, planning, responsible. I feel I can trust Cyril, whether I can or not, certainly have leading agenda. And as you spoke about yesterday, you seem to be able to get to know certain personalities. What Cyril trades on is a man of the people, a man of sincerity. We don't think that he's in league with the Gupta stealing the country. He doesn't give that part, but he achieves that through using the media. So now I think the moment has come for me to reveal to you, towards the ending, the greatest South African of all times. I'm willing to take some votes, but the vote has already been decided. Who is it? Siya Kolisi, who is the great of all times? Malema. Really, you know, I want to say about this South African the following. I want to say that I go down on my knees and thank God or the spirits, whoever, for this great South African who has rescued our democracy, rescued our lives. If it wasn't for this particular South African, I wouldn't be here. I've got my, what my friend calls my Villa Malema, another country, you know, if we have to run, we can go to, if all gets goes cow in South Africa. But this South Africa has saved us from other cows. This South Africa, by his bravery, his indomitable, fearless bravery, enabled us to escape from what could have been the biggest mess in the world, the Zuma years, and the corruption. One person stood up in South Africa. One person fearlessly didn't care what anyone thought of him and is willing to do what he had to do in order to save this country. And that person is the person who I nominate, greater than Nelson Mandela, greater than anyone, as my greatest South African. Sorry, wrong video. I'll get to Ravia. Almost there.
Who have assisted these these honourable
You are instituting a coup in
Zuma
the
IFP. Is not scared of us. He is scared of your men, not us. We are not going to do anything to leave the house. He is the Zuma, honourable Malema, you are the one who's not prepared to go. I hope this gentleman will
be. You can kill me, it's fine, kill me. Just kill me, there's no problem, kill me.
No problem, kill me. Did this really happen?
To harm others.
The president to speak here up until there is a process to rehabilitate him. There must be a rehabilitation process.
What have I broken, Honorable
Zuma is the one who must go.
Sergeant at arms,
yes, Honorable Johnson.
Pongwana, Honorable Matsuku, Honorable.
Chase people who violate the rules and keep a man who violate the constitution.
Honorable Malema,
you are prepared to chase out
Honorable
people
Malema,
who are protecting the constitution in the name of the rules.
Leave the
if
chamber.
There is anyone who must leave,
Honorable
is this
Malema,
one.
Leave the chamber.
I'm not going anywhere. I'm elected here.
We will assist you to go.
Wait.
We will assist
Let
you
me tell
to go.
Wait.
Because what one thing
we would like you to assist
that's
us.
What,
you.
That's exactly what made you nice. Not to be a candidate of the Women's League. Exactly that. Your conduct has failed you to be a candidate for president. Because you are irrational, you are impatient, you are partisan. Even your own people have dumped you. After they told you you are their candidate, you went home to do telling
order.
Ancestors you are going to be a president. After that, they dumped you because of this one.
Now, I think that at the time in South Africa, the bravery of that man was beyond belief. Could he have been killed? He saved us all. He saved us. He was the only person at the time who stood up to Zuma, the only person to say, pay back the money. He broke the dam. Like today, he's my absolute. But he is my greatest South African at the same time. One of the things that he could do, this great South African, he understood the use of the media. It is a bit relevant as well, Fiona. It is relevant because his use of the media is absolutely incredible. There's never been a South African, not Mandela, nobody who's understood the power of the message like this man. He is able to articulate the message well. He's able to get his people to come. He's done it with incredible bravery. There are times when I've been infuriated with him, especially recently. But at the time, he was for me a more iconic figure, more iconic than Helen Sussman. The way he stands up in these videos that you've seen over here and says what he has to say, his fearlessness. And if he hadn't done it, what would have changed? Where would the break in the ANC have come? We'd still have the Guptas running us in Zuma. He broke the dam, and that is why my nomination, it's been, the committee has accepted my nomination as the victor. He is the greatest African of all time, pipping out Nelson Mandela.
Exactly this conduct. How do you...
Now I have to tell you who the South African is who has been most seen in the media.